everyone. Today I'll be telling you something about the very common disease, that is hypertension or blood pressure in common language, as it is known to all of you. Hypertension is the most common cardiovascular disease affecting the human race globally. Hypertension, uncontrolled hypertension or uncontrolled blood pressure, is a condition which affects each and every organ of your body, starting from head to toe. And it is responsible for many cardiovascular diseases, namely stroke, heart failure, kidney failure, and heart attacks. In India, we find that there is a huge variation in the distribution, geographical distribution of the blood pressure. We find that Jammu, Kashmir, northeast regions, they are highly affected. There is high prevalence of disease in these areas. And as compared to Rajasthan and Uttar Pradesh, Bihar, we have more patients in south, down south. There are various reasons for that. There are genetic reasons, then there are reasons related to the lifestyle, your climate conditions. It is said that 1 in 4 adults, out of the 4 people, 1 person has got high blood pressure. And what is more pathetic is that only 1/3 of the people, only 2/3 of the people will know that they have high blood pressure, and 1/3 they don't know it, that there is high blood pressure affecting them. Why? I will let you know. Now, first of all, let me define what is high blood pressure. From time to time, guidelines keep changing, but on an average, for your understanding, if your blood pressure is more than 130/80, all the adult people I am talking of, 130/80, if it is more than that reading, this means we have high blood pressure. Now, depending upon the further increase in the pressure, we stage them. And how do we conclude that your pressure is 130 or 80 and beyond is, we tend to have average of 2 readings taken at 2 different occasions, and we follow a standardized protocol for that. What is that? I'll just give you an insight into that also. Very common notion is that people think that blood pressure is a condition which will affect, which is important for the people who are middle-aged, younger people. As you grow, the pressure has to increase. What is the great fun about it? That is the most misheld misconception which is there in the society. It is true that as we grow old, all of us are to have a high pressure. So much so that it is said that by 90 years of the age, 99% of the people will develop high pressure, which is high from the readings of 130/80. But then we can't ignore this pressure reading if we grow old. It has been found that the cardiovascular mortality, the death related with the associated with the high blood pressure, is much more in elderly age group as compared to the middle age group. Such is the importance of treating and controlling the blood pressure. It is said that for every 2 millimeters high in systolic blood pressure, we can have 7% increased risk of death due to heart attack and 10% increase in the rate of death due to stroke or the brain stroke, which you know by in common language. Now, once we check a blood pressure, we always advise our patients to sit, say, take rest, say 10 to 15 minutes before you get that blood pressure measurement. You should be rather comfortable sitting in the chair. Bladder should be empty. Try to avoid taking caffeine, smoking before you visit the clinic of your doctor, because that tends to increase your pressure. Then once the pressure is being taken, your arm should be rested on the table. Elbow should be at the heart level. Anything above or below it is going to change the reading. Similarly, try not to look at your mobile phones at that time. Try not to talk to the sister who is taking the blood pressure or to the attendants. Be calm, composed, and get your reading checked. Cuff size matters. whether we have not centered the cuff or not, that all matters. But that are the things which will be taken care by the medical practitioner who is checking your pressure. Sometimes what we find is that, and you must have noted yourself also, that the reading in the home is different, and once you reach a hospital or you go to a clinic, your reading gets up. This is something we call as a white coat reaction. That seeing a white coat, you get hypersensitive, you go into an anxiety form and your pressure rises. But then we have things to judge whether this is a some in white coat reaction, some related to that or anxiety only, or you truly are having high pressure. We have ways to find it out. So don't worry about that. But then this is one of the phenomena which can occur when we visit a clinic or a hospital. Now, when we check your blood pressure, it is just not only the reading of the pressure we concentrate upon. It is the in the totality we see the patient. What is your body? What is your age? What is your gender? What is your body weight? Whether you are obese or not? Then you have other risk factors for heart developing cardiovascular disease. Very important among them are whether you have a diabetes, do you smoke, are you already having a kidney problem, or you already having a heart problem, history of stroke or something vascular problem in the legs. And we calculate a risk like what is your 10-year risk of developing a cardiovascular disease. It is not just the pressure readings, what is your cholesterol levels and what is your family history of heart disease. All this matters. And if that risk is more than 10%, then we categorize you into a category which needs immediate attention, which needs immediate treatment, which needs initiation of treatment and the control of pressure. Now this treatment and the control of pressure, it may be with lifestyle changes, lifestyle measures, or maybe with the drugs, or a combination of the two. So we have to accept that if the pressure is this high, we have to be treated. Then sometimes some readings are so high that we cannot ignore them, and then we have to start the treatment immediately. Something like, suppose a patient comes to me in emergency and the pressure is 180 by 110. I cannot go by other demographic criteria. I have to start medicine. Otherwise, this patient will go into a complicated stage. Very important, very pertinent question when the person comes to me sitting opposite my chair in the OPD. We tell them that your pressure is high. The first reaction is denial. Doctor, how is it possible? I am not having any symptoms. Let me tell you here and clarify you all that if you talk to me about the symptom of high blood pressure, literally there are no symptoms of high blood pressure. You have to accept it. That, and I don't want to scare you by this term, but blood pressure or the hypertension is known as a silent killer. It is said that 99% of the time you don't feel any symptoms, and the pressure is high, it is damaging your organs, it is damaging your body, and you get to know only when you check it. If you don't check your readings, you can't tell that you are having high blood pressure or not. So don't be surprised if you visit a clinic for anything and you find your pressure high. Accept that reading and start acting on it. Then if the symptoms, and very important is, if the symptoms have started, usually the stage is a complicated stage. Not always, but most of the time it's a complicated stage that you presented. Suppose a patient may be having nosebleed, he may be having headache, and headache may turn out to be some brain stroke. He may be having nausea. He may be feeling short of breath, and nausea, short of breath, vomiting. He may be having inside either fluid in the lungs or because of the high pressure, or there may be some cardiac problem which has started, like he may present with an unstable angina, acute heart attack situation also in certain conditions. So this is just a way to tell you that our guidelines say that we have to target the blood pressure below 130 by 80 for almost everyone, whether you are in the age group of 40s, 50s, or you are in the age group of 80s or something, depends. And how much is your cardiovascular risk, as I already described, and also what are your other comorbid conditions, whether you are having diabetes also, you're obese, you smoke, you take alcohol, you have a family history, all this and what is your cholesterol levels, all this has to be taken. Now, as far as the drug therapy is concerned, we have full battery of drugs which can help you out in controlling the blood pressure. Which drug will be used for which patient depends upon, we select the drugs according to certain criteria. Suppose, what is your age, what is your gender, how active you are in the in your job, what is the nature of your job, then what are your cholesterol levels, are you having any other coexisting problem like diabetes, renal problem, then are you an old age group patient with a prostate hypertrophy, so on and so forth. So there are few things which we take into consideration before you starting on your medicines. If we are dealing with one demography, it's fine. Otherwise, demographically also people tend to differ. Americans differ, they respond to different type of drugs. Black Africans, they tend to respond better to some group of drugs and not to the others. So all this is known to your clinician. You have to just believe him. And if there are any side effects, you have to report to them back and the medicines will be adjusted accordingly. For you to understand, and what you can institute is the lifestyle changes, because it is the one thing which only you can do, and this goes a long way in preventing this condition and also controlling this condition. Mainly lifestyle changes mainly are basically how much physical activity you are doing, what is your diet, how much salt you are taking, whether you are habitual to smoke or alcohol, and all these things I take one by one. Most important and the foremost thing I consider for your well-being is the physical activity. I think it is second to none. If you are physically active right from your childhood, adolescent days, you are very unlikely to see a doctor in a clinic. That is my statement for all age groups, all both gender, all age groups. The reason is that exercise and the physical activity is one thing which keeps you away from all these lifestyle changes. Blood pressure, diabetes, people ask her what is the cause. I tell them it is a lifestyle disease. Lipid disorder, it is a lifestyle disease. It is how you conduct yourself starting from the childhood. No age is there which will not benefit from the physical activity. You have information on the Googles also, but people can get better, can have physical activity which can drastically change their life, even in the age group of 70s also. If we are 25, we are 30, we are 40, that is the best age to start the exercise if we have not been doing previously. It is said that the aerobic endurance exercises, they can reduce the blood pressure even in normal individuals, patients with normal blood pressure, and of course they are very beneficial in patients who have high blood pressure. Aerobic activity we consider like brisk walk, jogging, running, you playing some sports, badminton, cycling, all these come into swimming, all they come into aerobic activity where you are not using weights, but you are using your body and putting into motion. So it places demands on the cardiovascular system. The immediate effects, the long-term effects are tremendous. It's said that the reduction of the blood pressure with exercise can last up to 22 hours. Means when you next time go to the exercise, that is after 24 hours later, you are reaping the benefit of the previous day's exercise. And it is not always that if you lose weight, then only blood pressure will come down. Blood pressure can come down without you losing weight also with exercise. So we have, it is said that usually with regular physical activity, you can have a reduction in systolic and diastolic blood pressure to the tune of 2.5 to 5 mm just by doing exercise. We recommend that you should be preferably doing it all the days. If not, then at least 5 days a week. Intensity we recommend as a moderate. It should be 30 minutes of continuous activity. Sometimes, but it is not that if you can't do 30 minutes of continuous activity, you can't have the benefit of the physical activity. It is still there. Even this statement is important, that if you are sedentary and if you start walking, if you start doing simple things like not taking lift and the elevators and taking stairs, you are doing good to yourself. Even you are standing for some time in the kitchen, you are doing good to yourself. Even small amount of activity is helpful. Such is the tremendous benefit of doing a physical activity daily. But if you can do it in a consistent way, you can do it 30 minutes or more of a continuous activity, then you are reaping the maximum benefits. If you can't do that continuous, you can break it up for the during the day. Like 10-15 minutes I've done this thing, 10-15 minutes in the afternoon I've done something, in the evening I've done something. So aerobic exercise usually use your large muscles, but for the blood pressure patients, we have cautions also. If your pressure is too uncontrolled, it is more than 160 by 110, don't go for exercise immediately. First get your pressures controlled by the drugs and low salt and everything as per your doctor's advice. And once it is in the coming in down and it's in the normal range, you start your activity. This will help you in reducing your number of drugs, and also it will help in other ways like reducing your cholesterol levels, taking control of your diabetes, it will take control of your weight. Next important thing is alcohol. Now people are so much fond of alcohol, especially our male patients, they are so much into this that they feel that the statement should be that you are allowed alcohol daily. That is a complete no. The app, then you must be searching in the Google and you must be asking your colleagues that one or two pegs a day will help you. That statement comes with inverted commas, because if we say that some amount of alcohol is helping you in your coronary artery blockages, but this is not helping you in your blood pressure control, it is not helping you in controlling your weight, it is not helping in you in controlling your lipid profiles, it is not helping you as far as your muscle strength is concerned, heart muscle gets weakened with chronic alcohol use, then you have liver also. If you have no heart blockages but you have liver disease, what are we gaining? So there are so many side effects of alcohol, and as far as the blood pressure context is there, we say if you can avoid it, it is very, very good thing. But if somebody is taking alcohol, there should be at least 2 free days per week when you are not taking alcohol, and you should limit it to 1 unit a day. And these days we say the binge drinking is if you do take more than 3 units a day. And believe me, there are no safe limits for alcohol. Another important vice which is there in the society is the smoke. Smoke, I tell you, if all your risk factors, if I compare 2 people with the similar age group, male people, similar lipid profiles, everything is okay. But only difference between these 2 individuals, these 2 patients is, one is smoker, other is a non-smoker. The cardiovascular risk goes by more than double in a person who is a smoker as compared to who does not smoke. Such is the tremendous effect of smoke on their cardiovascular disease. Actually acutely increases the blood pressure, and it has other significant effects on your blood vessels. It damages the inner lining of the blood vessels. When it damages the inner lining, there is a plaque formation in those vessels. Plaque is a scientific term. In common language, we can say that there is a deposition of fat, cholesterol, and the inflammatory tissue coming out, inflammatory cells coming out, sitting on that fat and globules, which causes a thick raised structure inside the lumen of the vessel, and slowly it gets increasing in size. And what it does is it reduces your blood flow to the organ. Suppose it is occurring in the vessel supplying the heart. The heart vessels will get narrow down, your blood supply to the heart muscle will go down, and what you will land up in is, which we commonly know as an angina or a heart attack. Similar reduction in the brain supply can cause you a stroke, brain stroke. similar reduction in the kidney can cause kidney problems. So we, as far as possible, if we refrain from this bad habit, we can cut down our risk of heart diseases and brain strokes by salt is an important component when we discuss the blood pressure. Our recommendation is to limit your salt to 5 grams a day. But what happens is that most of the people, they don't know that there are invisible ways of you getting salt being absorbed in your body. So, and most of the time we find that what we are taking is almost double of the recommended dose. So how to avoid it? Go for low salt diets and prevent the intake of high salt substitutes. High salt things are when you go for a canned things, you go for processed meat, you take lot of bread, then you use sauce, achar, pickles, all these things in your diet more often. On the other hand, when you have lot of fresh fruits, vegetables in your diet, pulses, in the short, the nature found things, like the things which nature has offered to us, if you rely more on them in your food, in your diet, then you're doing real justice to yourself as far as this controlling this condition is concerned. If we say that there is 1.25 gram of salt per 100 gram of the food which you're eating, we label it as a heavily salted. And here I want to tell for our younger patients that once we snack outside, the person who is preparing food for you, who is not a homemade food, he is just concentrating on his benefit. He has to earn something from you. He is giving you something which is very palatable, very tasty to your, appealing to your tongue, but he is not taking care of your diet. He is not there to take care of your health. Who is the person who is really thinking about your health is the person who is sitting in the house and cooking for you. It may be your mother, maybe your sister, maybe your wife. So trust them instead of the people who are out to just make money out of what you are eating. Because it is said that one meal outside the house will undo your 15 days of precautions which you have already taken in your diet. So we advocate the DASH diet. What is a DASH diet? DASH diet is a very, you see how colorful diet it is. On your plate you have all the types of colors. There is yellow, there is red, there is green. In short, you have to include fruits and green vegetables in your diet. 3 to 4 servings of the fruits per day and lots of veggies on your plate. They help you a lot in controlling, preventing this condition. Now the fruits and vegetables, they have good phytochemicals, antioxidants. They have multiple vitamins and minerals which help you in coping up with the development and prevention of this blood pressure, high blood pressure. Now people say that instead of taking fruit, if I take this vitamin medicine, this capsule, it helps me. No. My simple answer is no. Never rely on supplements. If you are able to chew, if your body is able to digest the things, then go for the natural form of things. The small supplements can never help you. They are, first of all, they will have 1 or 2 concentrates only. Second, they don't get absorbed if you don't have a deficiency of them. They are just thrown out of the body. Sometimes their toxicity can harm you instead of giving you any benefit. Coffee intake usually is considered a small amount of high blood pressure in, may be there once you are taking it, but most of the time there is an antioxidant effect, there is an anti-inflammatory effect, and if you are not doing too much of everything, then you can reap the benefit of coffee. And it is said that once you are habituated to it, usually it is almost a neutral effect on the blood pressure. Dietary peptides, they are very important in reducing the blood pressure. Important product is a milk, which is so freely available to us, and we Indians are very fond of milk and milk products. Let's continue with our age-old habit of having milk twice a day, 1 cup before going to sleep also. children should also be inculcated this habit. And here I like to just tell my lady listeners that don't shy about, get shy from this product. This is very good for you. It's a good source of calcium also for you, not only in controlling the blood pressure, but it's a source of calcium and protein also. So another important thing is, this is stress. Though there is a no direct correlation we can find out from the scientific studies, but personally I feel that stress goes a long way in starting this condition and then persisting with it. So as far as possible, we should do have our lifestyle this way that we are not unnecessarily stressed out. We can plan our things, we can put them into perspective that what is the most important thing for me in the house. Is it the household work? Is it the recreational activities we do? Is it the society interaction which is important, or my health and my family members' health? And work of course is important for everybody, but whether that work should be made such a human cry to you that you damage your health, the ball lies in your court. So, and there are ways to cut down your stress also. You can have regular physical activities, one of the important things which can reduce your stress levels. Yoga, meditation, these are important things which can help you in reducing your stress and then controlling this condition. Herbal remedies is very important questions and queries from the people, and especially the older fellow. We agree with them. We have very good natural products which can help us in providing us with the antioxidant effects, and they go, if consumed properly over a long time, they go a long way in developing, in reducing the development of lifestyle diseases, which blood pressure is the most important, even diabetes is important. But this has to be combined with other good things which we require. It's not that we eat diet which is prepared outside, lot of oils, ghee, and we think that we'll have some ginger or some natural product that will counter it. That is not possible. And this slide just helps you in understanding that we have to understand the gist. We have to understand what our clinician or doctor is telling. Instead of going just on the words, we have to imbibe what it means. Now, if you have blood pressure, whom to consult? Initial stage, many people can help you. Your family physician, your GP, internist, your cardiologist, everybody can help you. But what are the points, what are the stages where you need a cardiologist intervention is when your blood pressure is uncontrolled in spite of having medicines, when you are requiring two or more than two BP medications for the control of pressure, then you have some end organ damage. Suppose you get some effect on kidneys, heart, or you have some retinal problems, or there is a epistaxis, nosebleed. These are the conditions that you need to consult your cardiologist. Or suppose you are planning some surgery for you, that is the point you will require a cardiologist's opinion. And to conclude, I like to say that after the age of 30, BP check should be regular and mandatory for all, and especially those who have a family history of diabetes, family history of hypertension, or have some other problems like coexisting renal disease, or there is a history of stroke, there are lipid abnormalities, so on and so forth. When diagnosed with hypertension, don't be in a denial phase. That is the most important thing we see in the clinic. Don't be in a denial, accept the thing and start acting that day only, so that you don't land up into complications. You have to control your blood pressure. It may be your lifestyle, it may be your medicines, anything. But the only end point is the controlled blood pressure should be there. As I already told you, it affects actually each and every organ of your body. And sometimes both things are required, lifestyle also, medicines also, depending on which stage you have reported to your doctor. And another important thing is we find that once the pressures are controlled, people are very hyperactive, anxious to get the medicine stopped or reduced. Never tell your doctor to do that. You are not supposed to be telling him that. Why he is calling you after regular intervals, why he is telling you to have a check on the pressure readings and report to with the blood pressure readings, the purpose is this only. If he feels like that your pressure is controlled and now you don't need three medicines, you are good with one medicine only, he will do that. But don't insist that you need a reduction of the pressure readings, and don't stop the medicine of your own also. This can do you more damage than better, than good. I think with this I conclude my slides, and if any questions or queries are there, you're welcome.